Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to the November 7th, 2021 service for First Congregational United Church of Christ in Zimbabwe. I'm glad to see you all here today. I'm glad to see some of our regular members and some regular visitors and some new visitors. Thank you for coming. Does anyone have any announcements they'd like to make today? The announcements that I have, the first is welcome to Tracy Valencia for accompanying us today. And you are going to be here for some of the first Sundays.
Yes, for sure. In December, I'll be here for the first Sunday. Yep.
Okay, thank you very much for your playing. And you will probably be playing Christmas Eve, won't you?
Possibly. I haven't been asked yet. My family might be going to Mexico to see my in-laws who live there. So
okay. Okay, well, you have a standing invitation. Thank you. My second announcement is this. I was reading the Zimbrota paper for this week, and the headline was ZM meeting adjourns early due to disruption. And the ZM meeting referred to in the headline of the Zimbrota paper is the school board meeting for Zimbrota Mazeppa School. And one of the topics of discussion for the school board meeting was mask policy. And there were 150 people there, according to the paper. And there was a sharp controversy about the advisability of masks and no masks during the school day. I'm not going to weigh in on that issue. What I am going to say is that is a symptom that disruption and the school board meeting having to be canceled is a symptom of what's going on in the country right now. And that is the disputes and the disagreements that we have. And we're always going to have disagreements because we don't believe the same things. And that's perfectly fine. That's the only way we learn one from the other. The difference is that today, a lot of us don't seem to be able to disagree without losing our tempers or name calling or disruptive activity and yelling. And all of us, every one of us, needs to be able to talk about important things while being in control of our emotions and being respectful of everyone. That's the only way we can be together as a society, and that's the lesson we all need to learn and keep learning. My last announcement is this. Advent is approaching. The first week of Advent is November 28th, three Sundays from today. And then December 5th will be second, December 12th will be third, December 19th will be fourth, and then Christmas Eve. We need volunteers for lighting of the Advent candle. So please, if you are interested in doing one of those weeks, with the exception of November 28th, because Parker Kwan is going to be doing November 28th, so December 5th, December 12th, December 19th, and December 24th, if you would, and your family would like to light the Advent candle, please send me an email or give me a call, and I'll be happy to arrange that with you. There is some reading involved, but it's only two or three sentences. So please think about that. It's a lovely thing to do, and it is a nice family activity. Would you please stand if you are able and bow your heads as I give the prayer of invocation this morning. Creator, we thank you for this world that you have given us. We thank you for bread and juice. We thank you for the seasons and the passing of time. And we thank you for the ability to worship together and the ability to be with our friends and neighbors. Amen. Please join me in singing our first hymn. Hymn 63, Holy Spirit, Truth Divine.
Sacred soul, Lord. We read about the Last Supper, when Jesus and his disciples shared bread and wine. Bread and wine. Symbols of forgiveness and love, relationship, and sacrifice. Please bow your heads. Jesus, we gather at your table to know you in the breaking of this bread. There are many times in our lives when we say things that we'd like to take back, and we do things to help ourselves, and by doing that we hurt others. It happens too much in our lives, God, and we feel shame and we feel sorrow for what we are able to do to other people. God, grant us peace. Grant us the knowledge that we are forgiven. Teach us to forgive ourselves, and teach us the security of knowing that you forgive us, and that we can go about our lives and say better words and do better things and make the world a better place. Amen. Please join me in praying as Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. On the night before his arrest, Jesus took bread and broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take this. This is my body, broken for you." Then Jesus took the cup and said, "This is the blood of my covenant with you, which is poured out for all of you." Holy Spirit, consecrate this bread and this cup, so that as we receive them, we may be united with God and with Jesus and with each other. Amen. Come forward, please.
Through the breaking of the bread and eating, we are part of the body of Christ. Please dispense the bread. Eat when you receive the bread, as we are all individuals. Through the cup of blessing, we participate in a new life with Jesus. Hold the cup until we can all drink at one time in community. The blood of Christ. Please bow your heads. Thank you, God, for inviting us to this table where we have known the presence of Christ. Strengthen our faith, our gratitude, and our love for neighbor. Amen. The benediction. Hear Jesus' promise for you. Ask, and it will be given to you. Knock, and the door will open. Seek, and you will find. Amen.
Please join me in singing hymn 282. Each time I feel the Spirit. Let's take some time to put away the things in our life, our concerns, our issues, our to-do list. Let's put them all aside for a few minutes. And let's be quiet. Sit back in the pew and close your eyes if you're comfortable doing that. And just focus on your breathing for a few moments. Take some time and breathe in and breathe out. And open your eyes when you're ready. And come back into this church. And let's listen to the Word of God today. And what the stories in the Bible mean to us in our lives right now. The first reading today is from Ruth, chapter 3, verses 1 through 5 on page 211 on your pew Bibles. 211, verse 3, chapter 3, verses 1 through 5. Naomi, her mother-in-law, said to her, "My daughter, I need to seek some security for you so that it may be well with you. Now here is our kinsman Boaz, with whose young women you have been working. See, he is winnowing barley tonight at the threshing floor. Now wash and anoint yourself and put on your best clothes and go down to the threshing floor. But do not make yourself known to the man until he has finished eating and drinking. When he lies down, observe the place where he lies, then go and uncover his feet and lie down, and he will tell you what to do." She said to her, "All that you tell me, I will do." On the next page, 212, chapter 4, verses 13 to 17. The end of the story. So Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. When they came together, the Lord made her conceive, and she bore a son. Then the women said to Naomi, "Blessed be the Lord who has not left you this day without next of kin. And may God's name be renowned in Israel. He shall be to you a restorer of life and a nourisher of your old age, for your daughter-in-law who loves you, who is more to you than seven sons, has borne them." Then Naomi took the child and laid him in her bosom and became his nurse. The women of the neighborhood gave him a name, saying, "A son has been born to Naomi." They named him Obed. He became the father of Jesse, the father of David. Our final reading is from the Gospel of Mark, on page 825. Chapter 12, verses 38 to 44. This story is often called the widow's mite, a mite being a speck of a thing. But first, Jesus is denouncing the scribes. As he taught, he said, "Beware of the scribes who like to walk around in long robes and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces and to have the best seats in the synagogues and places of honor at banquets. They devour widows' houses and for the sake of appearance say long prayers. They will receive the greater condemnation." He sat down opposite the treasury and watched the crowd putting money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums. A poor widow came and put in two small copper coins, which are worth a penny. Then he called his disciples and said to them, "Truly, I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the treasury. For all of them have contributed out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had, all she had to live on." This ends the reading. The title of my sermon today is Three Women. And I have said this before, and I'll say it again and again and again. Women had a very difficult life in the time of the Bible, in the Middle East. They had little or no say about anything. It was very rare for them to hold any sort of wealth. And at the bottom of every society in the Middle East were those widowed women who didn't have children, particularly male children. Because at that time, those were the ones who counted. The world was hard for them, And there was no one to help. No one to help them. The woman was shunned and was an outcast because she had no one to protect her. And if you weren't in her family or her relative, there was nothing for you to gain by helping this woman. You're only hurting yourself and your own family by helping her. In Numbers, chapter 27, verse 8, this is the way the inheritance worked for Israel. And this is God speaking to the Israelites. You shall also say to the Israelites, if a man dies and has no son, then you shall pass his inheritance on to his daughter. If he has no daughter, then you shall give his inheritance to his brothers. If he has no brothers, then you shall give his inheritance to his father's brothers. And if his father has no brothers, then you shall give his inheritance to the nearest kinsman of his clan, and he shall possess it. It shall be for the Israelites a statute and ordinance as the Lord commanded Moses. So there you have God's word to the people, saying how women shall not inherit the same way that men shall inherit. And when you read the Bible, this is also true. That if you are looking for a person who is willing to sacrifice, and if you want to find in the Bible a person who looks out for other people, look for a woman. A couple of weeks ago, I talked about Esther, who was made a queen in Babylon. And her people, the Jewish people, were going to be eradicated. And her mentor came to her and said, "You've got to do something, or we will all die." And at first, naturally, she didn't want to help because it put her at personal risk. Her life was at risk. And so she didn't want to do it. Just natural enough. But then her mentor said to her, "Perhaps you were made for this moment." And she acted, and she saved her people. Now the story is today, three women today, Naomi, Ruth, and the widow. Naomi leaves Judah because there's a famine and goes to Moab, which is not Judah and which is not Israel. It's a different group of people who are not God's people, according to the Hebrew scriptures. They're outsiders. She goes with her husband Elimelech, her son Mahlon, and her son Chilion. And while in Moab, Mahlon and Chilion take Moabite wives, non-Jews. Mahlon is married to Orpah, and Chilion is married to Ruth. Elimelech dies, leaving Naomi a widow, but she has two sons to help her. Mahlon dies. She still has one son to help her, and that's Chilion. Chilion dies. So there she is in Moab, a Jew in Moab, with the daughter-in-law Orpah and the daughter-in-law Ruth. And she has nothing. And Naomi tells Orpah and tells Ruth, you go back. I'm going to go back into Judah. But you go back to Moab. I cannot marry again. And I cannot conceive, and I cannot give you husbands. There's nothing I can do for you to help you. And I can't support you. So, thinking about her daughters-in-law, she says, you've got to go back, and I've got to go into Judah and try to make my way for myself as well as I can. And I can't help you. And you're better off without an old woman. Basically, is what she's saying to her daughters-in-law. I cannot protect you. I can't look out for you. I can't do anything for you. You're better on your own, getting a husband, and not worrying about me. That's the way you can survive. And Orpah, a good daughter-in-law, said, I don't want to do that. I don't want to leave you. But ultimately she did, because she had to make her way in the world. Ruth would not leave Naomi. Naomi wants the best for Ruth, and she tells her to go home and try to find a man to support her. And Ruth says to herself, I'm not going to leave this woman to fend for herself. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to take care of her. Even though there was no blood between them, I'm going to take care of this woman. Naomi comes back into Judah, and everybody sees her and says, hey, how are you doing? Welcome back. And she says, my name isn't Naomi anymore, because Naomi in Hebrew means pleasant. My name now is Mara, which in Hebrew means bitter. Naomi hatches a plot. Here's a man, Boaz, who's a rich kinsman of mine, my ex-husband, my late husband's. So why don't you get dressed up, and after he's done eating and drinking, why don't you go next to him and see if he will help? And there's a happy ending, as there sometimes is in the Bible, a happy ending. And Boaz marries Ruth, and they have a baby, and the baby is King David's grandfather. and Jesus' great, 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 great grandfather. Naomi wouldn't give up on Ruth, and Ruth wouldn't give up on Naomi. Even though Ruth was not a Jew, was an outsider. And it's important to mention that in the Hebrew scriptures talking about this woman's love for her mother-in-law. The third woman is the widow. We come to Mark, and Jesus talks about the scribes. Immediately before the story of the widow, Jesus talks about the religious leaders of the time. Not all religious leaders, but some religious leaders who devour widows' houses. And for the sake of appearances, say prayers. Now, if we fast forward a couple of thousand years, I wonder if this kind of seems like televangelists who take widows' homes and then give prayers and fly off in their private jets. And we end with a poor widow who puts together two pennies and puts it in the collection plate. Right after many rich people put in large sums of money, and Jesus doesn't talk about the rich people. Jesus talks about this widow. And it's important she's a widow because that's, as I said earlier, that's the bottom. That's it. You can't go down any further than that. And she has two pennies to live on. And that's it. And she doesn't think about herself. She's another woman in the Bible who doesn't think about herself, whose only concern is other people. And a woman who's willing to sacrifice. This widow is willing to sacrifice everything she has. Most of the Bible, the Hebrew Scriptures, the New Testament, most of the Bible, we believe, was written by groups of men. Some women might have written parts of it, but for the most part, it is written by men who were educated and could read and write and could put down the stories that they've heard for hundreds of years. And write them down and put them on scrolls, and then put the scrolls in vases, and then put the vases in a safe place. And we have them today because of that. So let's say it's written by men. And I've talked a lot about how powerless women were in the stories of the Bible and in that society. But when Jesus wants to prove a point, and when the writers are talking about people who are willing to look beyond themselves and willing to look at others and care for others and sacrifice for others, They tell these stories of these three women and many more. It's truly remarkable that these women made such an impression. That the love that they showed thousands of years ago is right in front of us today. Thanks be to God. Amen. Please join me in singing hymn 289. Come forth, O love divine. Now we have the opportunity to share the joys and concerns of this past week, the good things that happened to us and the bad things that happened to us, the things we're grateful for and the things that we're sorry for. Does anyone have any prayers they'd like to raise up? Yes.
We're very grateful today to have Eric and Kim join us from Chicago, and Eric's brother Neil, and the patriarch of the family, Jim Morton. Really thrilled to see you guys today. You're from Washington and Chicago, so I'm all over the place. So thank you so much for being here today.
Thank
Neil, you get the grand prize for traveling the farthest, I believe, Seattle, Washington. And we have a new car for you out in the parking lot. It's a brand new car. We spared no expense. We do this every Sunday. Whoever comes the farthest gets a new car. Would you bow your heads, please, as I give the prayers of the people? Holy One, we are grateful for the gifts you have given us, the gifts of friendship, the gifts of parents and grandparents and ancestors, a beautiful world, people who love us and people who we love. And people that we don't love and we might not like. But we've got to work together. And you, God, can help us with that. We pray for all of our members and friends who are not with us this Sunday morning. Bless them and keep them. Until we can be together and see each other's faces in that time. Please continue to encourage healthcare workers on the front line of the COVID battle and all of those who make time to help their neighbors and their family, including Crystal Budensek, who is helping her mother and father. We pray for students and teachers and administrators and educators and paraprofessionals and school boards who are all working together to make schools safe and places of education for our children. Bless them, O God. Bless them and strengthen them. And expand our ability to cut slack for others who might not agree with us, and to be respectful and honest and disciplined when we communicate. Bless Socorro Budensek, Bill, and their family as she transitions, as she regains her strength from her medical event. We have sympathy and blessing for Pastor Barb Copperwood's family, her husband Jim Borden, and children as they grieve Reverend Barb's death. And we pray for the family of Ursula Azor and Jerry Seagrass. Please keep them close to you, O God, and comfort them and lift them up. And lift us up as we go about our lives. Amen. Now, let's stand if you are able, and let's greet each other. And let us show each other how much we love and care one for the other. the inside back cover of your bulletin will be the peace song, Let Peace Begin With Me. Teach us that what is ours is really yours, and what is yours is really ours. Amen. Our final hymn today is hymn 76, Sent Forth by God's Blessing. 76.
Thank you.
Say kind words and do kind things and care for your neighbor and care for the world, knowing that everywhere you go, God is with you, always loving you.